Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Truth Will Set You Free show. This show is brought to you by TLBTV and the Liberty Beacon Project. I'm your host, Linda Diane Wattley. As you can see, I am so excited with my guest today. You know how I feel about my guest anyway, but I feel so much energy tonight, so I don't even care if I laugh, if I enjoy her, but it's so nice to meet someone that bears witness of the spirit of who and what you are. Her purpose is so unique in contrast to mine's, but there's a common denominator that makes us know that we're one. My guest, Ilona Selke, is that correct?
Ilona Selke, it is, yes.
Oh, wow, great. I said your name correct. I can mess up some names. But I want people to know that this is a person that, to me, has everything. She don't need to do no interviews. She don't need to share no CDs, write no books. She has arrived to a place in life where she knows that she is loved, she is cared for, and she is purposeful. But she wants people to know how important they are to life because we are so connected, and she is so conscious of that. And that's what excites me, is the fact that she don't have to do this, but she wants to do this. She's an amazing author, internationally author. She's a lecturer, a leader. She music?
Musician?
Really?
Yes, recorded, published.
Wow.
I'll tell you how I got started later.
That is amazing. And you share so much, like your book, the things you share to get people to a better place, especially in their mind. We call it conscious, but you deal with people's mind because you know there is where people get things done. That she offers so much: applications, CDs, books, lectures, online, offline, production. I mean, it's just endless what she gives. But what I like about her is she shares everything that she has for humanity. I have yet to hear her call herself a humanitarian.
Humanitarian. Well, that's so sweet. Let other people say that. My Bali staff does. Yeah.
And I thank you for that. She has written a book called Dream Big, The Universe is Listening. That book is phenomenal. I mean, just the title, The Universe is Listening.
Yes.
I mean, even before you open the book, I just have to say this. I'm just excited about this because of the positive energy. Mm-hmm. The Universe is Listening. When I read that title, I was like, wow. You hear everything I'm saying? Ooh. Uh-oh. I haven't even opened it. I haven't even read the acknowledgments. And that book made me look at myself. How are you doing, Ilona?
I'm doing really well. And I had such a great chat before we started this. So I'm super excited. I feel your spirit, and I feel your sincerity to be a light upon people and to humans, humanitarian in that sense. And I'm very touched that you take that energy to share to all of us. Thank you.
And you know, I usually don't jump quick to the book when people are my guests, but I have to know, how did you come up with Dream Big?
Well, I was interviewed by Jack Canfield. I co-authored a book with him called The Big Secret. And in my interview, which was aired in Hollywood Live, I was there in that Roosevelt hotel where Marilyn Monroe had been and some major names. So it was really meaningful. And here he is interviewing me, and he said, "So what are you working on?" And I said, "I'm working on this book, and it's about amazing miracle stories that teach people step by step on how to create their visions and goals and dreams and how to shapeshift time space." And then he said, "Do you have a message from your old self to your younger self? If you could go back in time and tell your younger self a meaningful message from your knowledge base now, what would it be?"
Wow.
And I said, "Dream big. The universe is listening." And he said, "Oh, that sounds like a book title." And I said, "That'll be it."
So,
and it was his, you know, Chicken Soup of the Soul. That's the author, co-author of Chicken Soup of the Soul.
Okay.
You know, Jack Canfield. He wrote inspiring stories left and right about how we in daily life can apply working with the miracles of spirit. And so in my book, I took it into the quantum physics understanding about bending time space, about how to have greater love life, how to create your manifest your soulmate, or how to really create time bending stories. You know, I mean, I don't know if you're going to ask me about some of them, but let's just say some amazing stories from myself as well as from other people. I have had one was I call her the Chinese princess, a student who came to Bali to one of my teacher trainings in Chinese. So I had a group of Chinese people training to be living from vision teachers, and we have the course in Chinese. And so for lunch one time, I sat and she had just taken a course in China, and it left her feeling like they tried to get her to dissolve the whole sense of self, the whole sense of anything. And she was sitting there rather depressed to begin with in this whole sin. And she was like, you know, and I have to say, if people get Buddhism in the wrong way, they say there is no soul, there is no spirit, we're just all, it's all one, and yet there is nobody home. It's like, well, why bother? Why do anything? It's the opposite of dreaming big. You know, it's the opposite of, you know, becoming someone. Well, and I said, well, as you dream big, your essence comes alive, because then you start doing things that really matter to you, that you really are excited about, not just making ends meet or not just reacting to all the demands that are put on us. So she's sitting there over lunch, and I said, "So if you really could have what you really wanted, how would your life look like in, you know, down the road when you're a little older?" She said, "Well, I would have a retreat center like you." You know, she was sitting with me at the Shambhala retreat center right on the ocean in Bali. And I go, "Mm-hmm." I had once somebody else say that, you know, and she did the course, and I'll tell you later, she got her dream. But she said, "Well, I would be," and she tells me in details, "there would be this mountain, and there would be nature, and there would be this retreat center." You know, where is a Chinese going to get that kind of money? They live in Beijing. I mean, not, she came from good family backgrounds, but, you know, she comes back. Half a year later, we meet at a conference in India, and she tells me, in Rishikesh, we all meet up afterwards. We go travel there together, and she said, I said, "So how's your life going?" And she said, "Well, you know, it's really interesting. We're running this institute now, and I was contacted by the government from China that I was elected to run this, get this. It's a retreat center that was only privileged to the princesses or the queen of China, and it's no ordinary mortals were allowed up there. It's in the mountains. It's all nature around. I have these pictures, all these Chinese buildings there with red roofs. And they were their institute for research on energetic medicine there, which they were working on with her husband." I said, "Well, I guess you got your dream faster than you thought." And she's like, "Oh my God." She didn't even realize that her lunch conversation, where she made up one of her wishes and had visualized for a short amount of time what she wanted, did come true in such, like, this was in October and she had it in February. Manifested a place where only, I mean, I wrote this up in my book, only Chinese princesses got to go, no ordinary mortal. And it's still guarded, and people have to register to go up there into their institute. And it's like my jaw dropped. shocked. And it's like, this was just a woman, you know, a Chinese woman. And you'd think like, no, that's not, you know, dream big. The universe is listening. And when in innocence, we ask, and it feels in alignment with our soul, all the forces are mobilized to create the pathways. And I always say, start with small goals, you know. Well, you know, and I didn't really think of it. It was just a lunch conversation, you know. But it formulated in her mind because that's when her soul got excited. And she woke up out of this, nothing is there, I'm not a soul, I'm nothing, into that's what I'm really excited about. And it's like part of her soul woke up. And that's what it's about. When we dream big, our internal essence comes alive. And we do things that, or start focusing on things that really matter.
Wow. And you know what? I know you are correct, because when I read your book, I was in a state of mind where I learned, because I read the Bible, whatever state thou in, be content. Mm-hmm. So I was very content with my life.
Good, yeah.
My children are fine. My mom is fine. I am fine. So I was content. But when I read your book, I began to remember I did have some dreams. But when I became, married with children and then widow, it was like I had to deal with what was in front of me. But something about that title made me realize that, but there's still more for you.
Yes. That's
but how do people realize that when they're kind of taught to just be content?
Right.
Don't be anxious.
Right. And that's, let's say, and there is a subtle balance between striving and always striving for more. And we know that. Those people, of course, living from vision, we also say, you know, be sure that what you choose is something you really are passionate about, that feels in alignment with your values. And we walk through discovering what the values are. One of the week's segments, the fourth week, is we dive into the value system, the deeper principles we operate from. And then in one of the weeks, we connect with the higher inner guidance system. You know, we have different religions on this planet, but they're all aimed at getting us to listen to the one source. For me, there's, you know, we don't have five different sources. There are five different gods. You know, there's one. We look at it differently. You know, that elephant in the room, one touches the trunk, one touches the leg. We may describe it differently, but in the end, it's one elephant in the middle, right? So we all are getting a different avenue towards the one something that's so miraculous. And when we set up a conversation with that, it's practically waiting for us to wake up to the fact that this universe is co-creative. So when you say, how do we get in touch with our real dreams? It's about, you know, we do need to take time. We need to be still. We need to sit back. Like you said, at first you reacted, you took care of your children. You took care of everything. And as women, we do that a lot really well, right? And then there are people who go like a bigger car, a bigger house, and more and more and more, and they're always busy. And the thing is, there is a balance between contentment or happiness and yet discovering more of who you truly are. And when your goals and wishes attend to your soul's needs, and where I give that app with a meditation away for free. If people come to my website, if I may say, the people can get it there. Is that okay?
Sure.
Okay. It's my name, Ilona Selke, I-L-O-N-A-S, like in star, E-L-K-E.com. If you go there, you can sign up for my newsletter and you get right away the access to an app called Living From Vision Light. And it asks you in the morning to what you want to create, but then also to start listening to your soul and really coming up with one wish that would deeply express your soul's wish for that day. And when we make that a habit, it just takes 12 minutes. When we make that inner vacation a habit, There's part of our soul that is satisfied, and this connective stream for the higher sources becomes, opens up like a highway, and then the divine can work with us and through us and create with us, for us, and with us and through us a better life for ourselves and the planet, I say.
But you know, you say soul with such conviction. What is soul to you?
Well, my mom asked me that. I remember as a teenager, she said, so where is the seat of your soul? And my sister, she was like, well, it's in my heart. And I said, you know, mom, for me, it's up there. She was a little shocked. It was just like, she wanted me maybe to say it was in my heart. And later on, I think my mom did a really nice example. She was a religion teacher and I was brought up Protestant. And she said, you know, the cross is really indicating two dimensions, one that goes this way and one that goes that way. And this way is how we connect to the source. And this way is how we express it. And you know where they meet, she said, in the heart. That's right where that center of the cross of the rising energy and the expressions. So it's in the heart that we connect to each other. It's in the heart where we give and where the differences don't really matter, because the heart speaks the language of the heart. Whether we speak Swahili or French or English, we know when there is love. But when we arise and go up to source, and that's what I said, for me, the soul was here, but the expression, and I have to admit, agree to my with my mom, is in through the heart. That's when spirit comes through. That's when we can care and give our compassion out. And the Dalai Lama says, if we can do only one thing and be kind, we've already achieved more than anything we could have ever hoped for as a human evolutionary step, you know? So for me, soul is like a presence, is an internal luminosity. And I feel it. And, you know, I train in soul awareness seminars with people. And if we, you know, of the chakras, right? So we have the third eye, we have the crown chakra, the throat, the heart chakra, the solar plexus, the sacrum, and the root chakra. Well, when we keep going upwards, and this is maybe a little bit outside of the camera, but when we go up, we have energy points as if we have nodal points or chakras that keep going finer and finer and finer into infinity. And when we each awaken the most infinite point or the most closest to the source we can in ourselves first, and then we connect with another that way. That's when we feel love flooding our heart. That's when we feel really connected and see the true light of another being.
Wow. It's strange that you had mentioned your mom, but your mom set the foundation for you to receive truth. Share with us how your mom said she found you was in the Himalayas. Where did she find you?
Yes, she found me. Yes, I was born in the Himalayas. I was to both German parents. And when my mom was pregnant with me, my parents traveled through India. Actually, my mom said jokingly many times, I think I picked up your soul in India. And you know, I don't do it for radio shows all the time, but I normally wear a little glitter here. So my mom was exposed to all the hippie teachings, but she wasn't a hippie in the 60s. She did yoga, and then she taught me something that was probably the most valuable tool. Two things, actually. She taught me to discover truth from the inside out. Instead of telling me what to do, she said, listen to your inner voice. And it, you know, she was in the forest with me and my sister, and she said, now listen to the silence. Do you hear the silence? And I'm like, Mom, I don't think so. She did yoga with me, and she's like, okay, now breathe this yogic breath, you know, the alternate nostril breathing, and then look into the root of your nose at the center of your third eye. And I keep looking at it and going, and I'm like, Mom, it's black in there. No, you'll see a light. Well, eventually, it took me a couple, almost a decade later, I managed to see the light, you know. But that was, but the question, I remember when I was 6 years old, we were on vacation, and she said, do you want to wear warm clothing or cold clothing? And I said, I don't know. And instead of telling me what to do, she said, well, hold out your hand out the window and feel, what does it feel like? I'm like going, oh, I don't know. It's kind of warm, I guess. You know, as a six-year-old, it's kind of difficult to distinguish those things. But it teaches us from little on to learn to listen to what is true. So I never smoked. I never did drugs. I never got drunk. I never did any bad thing. And hallelujah, and thanks for my mom. She never pushed against me. She just asked me to listen to my inner conscience. And she fostered that. So that was number one. Number two, I think what I really love now in retrospect, asked me to pray in a free style. And she said, well, what would you ask God to do or be or share or help with? Oh God, please help that the little birds sleep safely tonight. It's really cold outside. Please make sure they're safe. You know, I remember that prayer. And it just sets up this trust that there is another something listening, co-creating reality with us here. And that belief alone is the magical fuel when we start saying, I would like to create whatever it is, like a TV show for you, or I did what I did, or my books for teaching, or I said in one seminar, I want to travel internationally, have houses here and there, and do this and that, write books, meet these and these people. And I was this big with a hat on at the time. You know, I was a massage therapist. My husband was a chimney sweep. And we were, you know, literally this big with a hat on. Well, times changed. Things changed around us like a whirlwind only because we started to dare to dream. And we believed in a higher force.
But another thing your mom keyed you into was books.
Yes, yes. You're so sweet. Yes. I read Aladdin, you're talking about that one, or Hermann Hesse's, or Siddhartha. Which one are you?
You realize how valuable they were.
Yes.
You realize that those books was transformation for you. So it was only normal that eventually you saw an avenue
to reach people.
Because you knew that it can't fail.
Well, you know what? Actually, when I was 16, I read Plato and I thought, I could have said that. You know, then I kept reading and I'm like, I loved writing. But you know what? People often say, what's my purpose in life? And I've got an easy answer. If you do your numerology and you figure out your talents, and it could be your name analysis with numerology or your birth date, 99% you will be given specific tools and specific reflections of what you're good at. And you probably already know that. For me, it's communications, it's inspiration of other people. That's my job. I love Dan Millman's book. You know, the one who wrote The Peaceful Warrior, to the book, The Life You Were Born to Live. He actually has an app for it. And it's the number for your life. And mine happens to be a 30, 30. Wow. And all 30s, 30s are people who are here designed to, in an upswing, inspire other people through creative arts, expression, words, writing, could be music, could be performance. The downside is the threes tend to doubt themselves and they come across potentially as cooler and more aloof than they actually feel. So any of you out there who are a 30, please know that other people might think you're much more calm and collected inside. You have deep emotions that yearn to be expressed. But the thing is, when a three, and people who have a three in their number, tend to be psychic, sensitive, tuned in, can read other people's minds. So it's in your numbers. It's in my numbers. But what we feel is our purpose is actually the soul inside of us awakening, expressing itself through our talent. Now, it's the soul's light that when it wakes up and it expresses itself through our talents, that's when we feel we're living our purpose. And, you know, can I share the little story about what I found out with kids when they are asked, what is your purpose in life?
Definitely, please.
So I do this work with teens, adults, and adults, and therapists and doctors. So when I've done this work with children and ask them, what is your purpose in life? They're all eager. They go in and do this guided meditation and come back all excited. And they say, oh, I found out. I'm here to shine more love and more light. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, wow, that's awesome. Adults.
It's the bottom line.
It is bottom line. I take adults through the same guided meditation. They go in there all excited to find out what they're here to do. They go in, they come out, and they say, well, I didn't find out that much. I only found out that I'm here to shine more love and light.
That's all.
And the kids are so excited. They figured it out, the real purpose. It's so simple. And the adults think it has to do about being a baker or whatever, or a bricklayer or a book writer or a teacher. Those are your talents. So there are talents, and you can find out what they are by studying your own numerology. Or you can just illuminate your soul. And by doing the Living From Vision course, people wake up to their passion, and then they dream this and this, and it leads them more and more into talking to their bigger self, their higher internal guidance system. So I hope I answered your question there.
I was telling people how I feel like you have everything. So basically, you share everything, and one of the main things you have is Don.
I do.
Tell people about that miracle.
Oh, that was amazing. Bless my ex-husband's heart. I met him when I was 17 because I always wanted to marry an English-speaking man, and he was. And in the end, he brought me to Baltimore, Maryland. And when I went to study philosophy and comparative religion in Maryland, I, at that point, started to become disenchanted with my husband. He didn't want to make love as much or hardly ever. He didn't want to go hiking with me. He wanted to do work in the yard. He wanted to read his newspaper and could only see his white hands. And, it just wasn't the life I had dreamt of.
But
I was 21 and a half, but he put me on the path. Bless his heart, and I love him still. I just met him, Don and my husband, and I just met him yesterday here in Seattle. Wow. So what then happened is I decided, okay, I'm continuing with meditation. I'd studied numerous things. I was now in Baltimore and called up this center for meditation. And a beautiful voice comes on, and it's like, let me take you to the high road to God. I sign up, I leave my message, I come in there, I greet the man behind the curtain with that voice, I sit down, I become his student, and after a while, I tell him, I'm not so happy with my husband, and what do? I want him to do this and this and this, and I want him to be more sexual, more spiritual, I want him to meditate, I want him to talk to me more, and he said, hold it. He said, you can imagine what you want, and see yourself in the future as if it's fulfilled. But don't tell the universe the face you think it should have, because you don't want to force people into who they should be, right? So I did what he said. I visualized being in that fulfillment every day and felt that feeling of like, yes, I flourished in my own meditation for a short moment every morning. Sooner or later, my wish was fulfilled. It happened to become the face of my meditation teacher, Don. So I met him when I was 21 and a half, and I'm 57 now, so you can do the math. It's been a lot of years, and we are in love and happy and grateful. And we're helping people, and we knew that long time ago, right away, that we need to help people discover the power of soul awareness, of connecting with a higher source, and that we are co-creating reality, that consciousness is what is around us. And that our focus creates and looks back to the source as the source looks back on itself. And it becomes this, the part and the whole become one. And that is the miracle. When we are one with God and God is one with, when that dialogue happens, the heart opens. And that's when we have true contentment or true happiness. And then everything flourishes. You just dream and you can't help it but be creative. So then things take on shape and you become a positive agent in life for yourself and for others. So that was how the magic with my husband happened.
And the thing about it is, you also emphasize the value of sexuality. You know, sex plays a big part in the balance of the soul. And you introduced in your book to have sexual experiences without even physically touching one another.
Right. And I think a lot of women in their menopause could really benefit if they knew, husband and wife, how to make love in an erotic way without necessarily even having to get naked or frisky. They can. But yes, I was young and I was very blessed to meet this amazing genius musician who took me on a trip in the summertime. And I remember we took on this bicycle trip. We bicycled in slow motion. And when we arrived at the bed and breakfast where we were to stay, they gave us, looking at him being in his mid-30s and me being 19, two separate beds back to back with head to head, you know, or feet to feet or something. So we took our lovely bedtime there. And, you know, we hadn't at that time done anything. And which really makes you creative, doesn't it? So instead of fumbling all over me and instead of trying to take my clothing off, he simply started taking my hands. And ever so subtly, being a musician, he had, mind you, this greater classical world of movement that he could follow. So he was a perfect candidate to initiate me into movement of energy and color and feeling of communion and burning into this ecstatic crescendo of breathtaking ecstasy that we experienced. And then later on, I still practice with my husband because the energy bodies, they interpenetrate. If we learn to listen to the body and learn to direct it and open our energies and feel them with each other, we can interlink without having to physically even move. We can, but if you combine the two, it's bells and whistles. But you can learn to direct your energy bodies together. And when you learn to awaken your soul source, you can touch the source. And I've meditated with men and children alike in silence and merged into union of consciousness. And they all say, it's better than sex, and it's like coming home. They often usually say the latter first. They say, it's coming home when we consciously merge into singularity. So if you have someone you want to practice with, you can eye gaze, you can experiment feeling something beyond. Keep your gaze upward and aim to the source, aim to the one and single source. And I teach it in seminars. I've had people wake up. I've had people who have meditated for 20 years going, they only go to a ceiling that they believed existed. And then I just said, keep going. And they kept going. And then it's like, oh my God, there is a universe out there that is way beyond what we've ever thought possible.
So you're not saying that's part of the holographic universe that you speak of?
It's beyond, you know, soul and consciousness have many different cloths. The hologram is like taking on clothing, but it's beyond, you know, these are physical clothing. These are like the blueprints. If you saw a blueprint around me, my belief systems have a blueprint. What I expect subconsciously is a blueprint. But the invisible force, the source, is what illuminates it, what gives it force, what births to existence. And it's like we can't help but dance. Whether we sit still on a mountaintop, we still are dancing our life. We live. That's what we're designed to do. We are here to, at as best as we can, express that aliveness and that current of the source. And whatever we are capable of, it expands us. So that part is beyond time and space, beyond the blueprint. The hologram, the form, it's like the Big Bang before it was a Big Bang. You know, that power, that energy that created the Big Bang, if we could go into it and through it, into that source, that's where soul and pure consciousness resides. But then we have consciousness like the Big Bang, and it's like form takes on and it just becomes a dance.
And you know, dreaming big is really more to it than just receiving things.
Yes, yes. Thanks for pointing that out. Yes, I love all your questions. I love where you go inside. I love your presence. I really am honored. Thank you. It's way more, you know, it's always the people who think, no, you shouldn't have any wishes, because there are people who say, I don't want to do anything but the will of God. I still see them sitting at home. They say, well, I'm still waiting for that. Don't do something. Well, I went hiking once, and I wrote it up in the book Wisdom of the Dolphins. And I went and tuned into the trees, you know, who can't walk or talk or do anything. And they stood still, and they talked to me in my head, and they said, you are the dreamer. You have hands. You can express your dreams. That's your purpose as a human. So we, with, and this is something I've written also in other books, not only dream up for ourselves, we dream at a larger collective level. And as we anticipate, good or bad, that's what we start creating or seeing around us. And if we're willing to create a better place for ourselves and others, we will have impact on a larger global scale in the universe that we occupy. You see, we think there's only one universe. Nope, there are so many vibrating realities. And I find when I drop in my vibration, I don't do my daily whatever work or skip on a little bit, just do, you know, for me, half an hour is not enough. So I do my minimum, but if I do, it's okay. If I do even less, it's like, I have to work harder. Things aren't lining up. If I go up, I can just barely have a thought. Things line up. The right people line up. The right things happen. And stories involve me traveling that I've written about in this book and others. It's like magical. Do you see the internet connection working? Yes, there I am. Okay. So the consciousness is what creates the outcome. And we are technically parts of God living in form. So remind me again what we were trying to get here at.
Basically, you know, it takes me into what you were saying, our purpose. You know, like a lot of people don't realize it's not just about getting things.
Right.
It's like the universe needs for us to be established in the right vibration.
Yes. And when I have dropped, that's what I was saying. I just saw that the internet connection had stopped a little bit. So when I drop in vibration, then my universe starts going like, but then I raise myself and it's a different universe. I have created and seen, miracles. I was in Hawaii, we had a house there by the beach and lived there half the year at a time and lived by a dolphin beach. And one time we came back and there were these junker cars lining our street. And I lived right on the forest preserve. And I'm like going, God, this, I've done all this amazing work. This is not right. So I sit down, set up our house, meditate, and say, I had talked to my neighbor, just mind you, just a half an hour before, and she said, oh, she's called the police, she's called the county for 3 months, nothing has happened. I mean, it's like no go. It's like, so I've said, I'm done. This has to change. I sit down and I visualize a clean street. I didn't care about how, whether the police came, the county came, or somebody came, I didn't care about the how. I cared about the end result. So what I then did is felt what I would feel like when that street was pristine and clear, like my heaven on earth, my paradise. We were living right on a forest reserve, just a couple streets down from a dolphin beach. I mean, it was magical. All right. So I'm sitting there. I'm feeling it. I'm feeling it. It's in my bones. And I say in my bones, you know, people who spell really well, who are like 100%, they oftentimes say the same thing. They say they feel it. They know it. It's like there's a, it lines up and it's a thunk. It's a feeling it in your bones. When you can believe it down to the last DNA molecule in your heart and bones, that's when things can really quickly happen, magically happen. And I felt that. And then I heard a crunchy noise out there. And I'm like going, could that be? They're already being picked up. I mean, my God, that was quick, 20 minutes later. But then I thought, oh, well, they're building a house next door. So I better not go look. You know, I'll just stay in my feeling and kept my meditation going. Then we went to shopping. We just arrived from the mainland, and so we had to go shop food. We drove off. I didn't even bother looking what happened to the cars. I'd forgotten. Ready in my fulfilled future. I didn't care what the reality was. Then I thought, you know, that sound, you know, maybe that was somebody picking them up. I forgot to look. On the way home, we drove home, and the street was clean. Three junker cars were gone. Now, you can go and say, whoa, well, maybe, I don't know, maybe it just coincidentally happened. But I've experienced so many amazing miracles like that when I move into that parallel universe. Remember when I said there are many worlds simultaneously? You slip into the one that you want to be in. And when all of you align in all of your molecules, in your every vibration you have, into that universe, and all of you can say yes, all of your parts inside of you said that I'm ready for that, that's when it will manifest. So that's the key. You have to be in the future fulfilled, feel it like it's happening, and then don't question when it is happening. Why, you know, how? It's like, great, I arrived in the miracle universe where I wanted to be. I don't need to make it a smaller or bigger story. It's just what it is. Thank you, God. And live in your paradise or your heaven on earth, whatever it is that is right for you.
You see, you're talking about dreaming big. And when you're talking about dreaming big, you're talking about manifestation.
But like you said, connecting with your source soul purpose is what the end result of dreaming big does. It aligns that you live in a beautiful universe. You like become an agent of the divine. Sorry, interrupted you. But yeah, I love that you point that out.
But see, the thing people tend to give up on is, why have anything manifested that I have projected out into the atmosphere? But when you read your book, you come to realize what you believe, your comfort zone, all of that plays a big part.
Right. That's exactly what determines our end result. Whatever we feel innocently like saying, yeah, why not? I can see that. That's what will happen.
I tell you, another thing too is a lot of people, they're always looking for companionship. Mm-hmm. And one of the things you wrote in your book is you actually subconsciously draw that person that's perfect for your soul and where you are. You're like, how did he get in here? I didn't want him.
Stop.
Somewhere it was a match.
I remember writing in that story that in my book, I discovered it when I was 16. I had some experiences where I wasn't really that bad, but other people started, like, I went to Israel and they were like, yeah, and made up stories about me. Like, I had done things that I had never done. And I'm like going, just alone, the fear of that bad reputation made me go, I'm not going to be that kind of a woman. I mean, no way. And I rejected sexuality in a way, even though it was other people's figments of the imagination, it mattered to me. So I became, you know, proper in no way, you know. Well, then I found my ex-husband, remember, who was quite willing to cooperate with my belief system, let's say, you know, but I didn't know I had it. I had thought, well, I'm just going to wait for Mr. Wright. And then he showed up. He fit the picture. I mean, he did. He looked like the rifleman. That was one of my ideal images as a child, you know. And then he fit my subconscious picture as well. And like you said, the beliefs, the feelings of what we hold, whether we know it or not, in our hearts. And he presented it really well. And I didn't know that he actually, until afterwards, when I said I had enough, I want sexuality and I want to stand up for it. And yes, I want it. It manifested, but you know, you do get for what you're ready for, but you have to say yes. All of you has to say yes. And so when I did that, went down, but he had the same experience when he had been that much younger. He had made the same judgment on himself, closed that part up, said, I'm going to be all spiritual now, meditate, no more, none of this, you know. And then he found a wife who was all too willing to wait, you know, a month or so or two between, you know, being sexual. And that was just not really quite enough. But it reflected his subconscious beliefs. And then at one point, he said, you know, spirituality and sexuality and having life flow can all work together. And that's when we met.
And another thing that tickled me too was, I think you said around the age of 11, you wanted a bike.
Yes.
This is important when people don't realize you learned something very serious there.
I did. You want to tell me what I did?
Yeah, I know what you
did. Wrong first? You know, all too often we focus on what we don't want. True? We go like, we just have all the objections. We think, no, but can you think not of the pink elephant? Can you not think of that big pink elephant in the middle of the room if I say, don't think about it? What do you think first when I say that? The pink elephant, right? So it's the same thing. But when I was 10, I thought I'd figured out that I Dream of Genie show, right? Who could wiggle her nose and go like this and get everything she wanted. So I thought, I'm going to become a genie. Or like Aladdin and the Wonder Lamp. Manifest things. Well, when I tried my luck at it, I seemed to only get what I didn't want. You know, I got all the things I had not wanted. And I just couldn't figure it out. But I thought, okay, maybe it's true. What I don't want, I get. So let me trick my universe. And for Christmas, I'm not going to want a bike. None whatsoever. No bike, bike, no bike, no bike, no bike. So I went to school. I remember putting my foot in front of the other and going, no bike. I don't want a bike. Hypnotizing myself, you know. I thought, let's see. Maybe the universe is listening and will not give me a bike because I was not wanting a bike. So now had to get the bike, right? Because I always got what I didn't want. All right, Christmas comes and I got my bike. So I figured out the universe has a law. It's what we don't want, we get. Well, I did grow up from that and realize that the universe does not hear no. As you know, as we find out, but all too often we say, I don't want to scream at my kids. I don't want to have this and this happen. This is impossible. We make all these no's around us, like a big wall of a radio station that says all these things to the universe. Just doesn't hear the no. So we shouldn't be worried, surprised when the things manifest that we didn't want. When we speak, remember one sentence. Say mean. And mean what you say. All too often, and in this modern day, people use sarcasm, they poke at each other. We say, if we really are vulnerable in our heart, we say, I love you. We can say, I feel hurt. But what people usually say is they hide behind words or they poke. And it's like, it's a surefire way of not getting what we want. So be mindful of your speech. Say what you say. And that was the upshot of the not story. So remember, the universe does not hear not. It simply sees what you imagine and what you feel.
It's just a beautiful journey. And I really appreciate you for coming on our show today.
I love that you're doing this show. And you know, you vibrate. You vibrate in your consciousness. And you not only talk, you speak. speak wisdoms. And I feel you. Thank you.
Well, thank you. If people want to get in touch with you and get your book, I mean, your apps and everything that you have to offer, how do they get in touch with you?
Thanks for asking. So you can go to the website livingfromavision.com. That's easy to remember, right? Livingfromvision.com. Another one where you get my app to start your day right and end it on a good note, that's from my homepage, Ilona Selke. It's I-L-O-N-A, Ilona Selke, S like in star, E-L-K-E.com. IlonaSelke.com. You sign up for my newsletter, you immediately get the app. And on livingfromvision.com, you can test it around. We have the Living From Vision course where people can study over a 5-week course to manifest step by step. And I've been teaching trainers and coaches for the last 30 years. It works miracles. And we have the course in English, Spanish, French, German, Czechoslovakian, Chinese. It's being taught all over the world in all continents. So it is working. I've taught dropout kids. All the teachers have, and up to CEOs from companies who've left their job teaching this material now. So a Living From Vision light app you get for free to test drive it and to get in touch with your soul. Just give yourself that mini vacation, start your day out right, going within, creating from the inside out, ending your day on a good note. And so those are the two websites, IlonaSelke.com and livingfromvision.com. My book, Dream Big, The Universe is Listening. You can easily go to Amazon, just type in Dream Big, The Universe is Listening. You can get it on Kindle or in paperback. So that's the easy way to do it.
And Ilona.
Yes.
You are on The Truth Will Set You Free show. Give us a truth to remember you by.
The truth, dream big, the universe is listening.
Oh, wow, that is big.
The universe is listening. That is phenomenal. Can you imagine that there is something that is listening, that our intimate thoughts, our everything we feel is being listened to by a more benevolent force? It's not there for the big eye to watch us. It's the love. It's like, it's given us life to live.
You know you have to come back.
I love you, Linda. Thank you for the show.
Love you too. Take care.
You too. Bye-bye, Linda Wattley.
Bye-bye.
Bye.